يحيى خذ الكتاب بقوة وآتيناه الحكم صبيا
إذ قال الله يا عيسى إني متوفيك ورافعك إلي
محمد رسول الله.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. سورة الأنعام, the beautiful surah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, that has this subject which is the most important of all subjects, which is the Tawheed, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The subject that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send the messengers to call people to, reveal the books for that one purpose, and that is to worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And in this beautiful surah, we saw how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed these verses with all kinds of clear evidences that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful, that it is sufficient for the people to be invited to La ilaha illallah. There's no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is by itself, it's sufficient because it fits the nature of the human beings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them with this thing in their innate, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of the Alameen. So therefore, He's the only one worthy of worship. But still Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the messengers and revealed the books, and the surah has so many evidences about the subject and refuting the calls of the disbelievers and how they oppose the truth with nothing but falsehood, of course. And the falsehood has no basis to it whatsoever. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the most just, He is the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that no doubt whatsoever is left for the human beings or any arguments, everything is made very clear. And inshallah ta'ala, in this episode we'll go through the last four verses in this blessed surah, Suratul An'am, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in these last four verses about the purpose of our life, that the entire life is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how can a person take other than this beautiful religion and this beautiful way of life, the perfect, the haqq, the truth, to take other than this as a way of life or matters of belief and so on. Very clear verses that sums for us the entire surah, Suratul An'am. So let's go through these verses, the last four verses in Surat Al-An'am, starting with verse number 162. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in this verse, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِي لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ وَبِذَلِكَ أُمِرْتُ وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ مُسْلِمِينَ. Which roughly means, say indeed my prayer, my rites of sacrifice, my living and my dying are for Allah, Lord of the worlds. No partner has He, and this I have been commanded, and I am the first among you of the Muslims. قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي. قُلْ, as we heard it many times before, which means say. And who's the one that is ordered to say? The Prophet ﷺ. And the ummah of the Prophet ﷺ are also ordered to convey this message. قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِي. إِنَّ, indeed, no doubt, صَلَاتِي, my prayer, my salah. And we know that as-salah means the dua, means the supplication, means our obligatory salah, pray five times a day as an obligation, and then the nafl and the optional salawat and so on. And this is what it means here, our prayers. Prayer has a specific way to be done according to the way the Prophet ﷺ starts with the takbir and ends with the taslim. So this salah is a way of life. It's the life of the believers. There's no Islam without salah whatsoever. This is as the Prophet ﷺ, he said, الْعَهْدُ الَّذِي بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَهُمُ الصَّلَاةَ فَمَنْ تَرَكَهَا فَقَدْ كَفَرْ. The covenant between us and them is the salah, whoever abandons it or leaves it, he had committed an act of disbelief. And this is the thing between a person of being a Muslim and a non-Muslim when it comes to actions. A person would see a Muslim, definitely he would pray the five times prayer on time. And therefore the salah becomes the life of the believers, the life of the tawheed, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we say that the meaning of La ilaha illallah means there is no one worthy of worship except Allah. And then where is the worship? Here's the salah as a manifestation to the meanings of worship. That a person is constantly, as if he is constantly in that state of worship of Allah. If the purpose of our life to establish the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is established by something like the salah. As if the entire day and night, a person is in the state of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when a person fulfill the obligation of the five daily salah. And if you remember that at first, these salawat, they were 50 of them in the night of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj when the Prophet ﷺ ascended to the heavens. And he was given the order by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala directly. Jibreel alayhi salam was not the intermediary at this time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the order to this ummah to pray 50 times a day. Then it was reduced to 5, as it's mentioned, the long hadith of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. And at the end it was said, as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, خَمْسٌ فِي الْعَمَلْ خَمْسُونَ فِي الْأَجْرِ 5 in action, but 50 in rewards. And it's meant to be this way, for us to see that this is our life. As if a person is created for nothing but to establish the salah. This is the goal. As if it's 50 salah a day, person would not be able to do anything in this life. He would run and rush back again so that he would make the next salah and so on. But that's not the case. It's only 5. That means what? This is the purpose of our life. This is the goal of our life. And everything else serves this goal, not the opposite. So when a person goes to work, that's not the norm. This is not the principle of his life. This is not the goal of life. This is nothing but a mean to establish the salah. Wealth and health and families and relationships and whatever a person do on the face of earth, it's nothing but a mean to establish the purpose of our life, which is, as we see, the most obligatory act whatsoever is the salah, after the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meanings with the matters of the tawheed. So قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي, and the significance of that, وَنُسُكِي, the sacrifice, slaughtering for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we know that this is part of the religion, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed these cattle for the human beings, for them to eat and to have all kinds of enjoyment with regards to the services of these cattle, but with the condition that a person realize and understand that this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the one that created them, and no one has the right to take this life except by the permission of Allah. That's why we say Bismillah. So our slaughter is for the sake of Allah. And we heard before how the disbelievers, they slaughter to other than Allah. They slaughter to their idols that they worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They slaughter to other than Allah, which is one of the acts of shirk and associating partners with Allah. The same way a person making sujood, prostration to other than Allah, which is an act of disbelief, an act of shirk, associating partners with Allah because this is an act of worship. The same way if a person slaughter for a person in a grave or for an idol or for whatever there is. And some of the Muslims today, they do these types of things where they slaughter by the graves and so on. This is basically grave worshipping. And we're supposed to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. So the nusuk here is mentioned because this is the way of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and this is something that we do in Hajj, in the Eid al-Adha, and things like this, and it's supposed to be only for the sake of Allah, not for the sake of the human being, and that's why we say Bismillah. So say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna salati wa nusuki, and my sacrifice, which is opposes the ways of the polytheists and those who associate partners with Allah, wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alameen. Mahyay means my life. Mahyay, my life. Haya is life. So my entire life, and what else? Wa mamati, and my death. So life and death. And before that, the salah and the slaughtering. That means there's nothing left. The entire life that a person lives, matters of worship, whether it's involving salah, slaughtering, life itself. And mahyaya includes everything that a person do in his life. Whether it's something to do with the acts of worship that has certain rituals to it, or halal, haram, what's permissible, what's not permissible, what a person eats, what a person drink, relationships, families, children, relatives, work, wealth, neighbors, the streets, the schools, whatever there is, you name it, it comes under the category of mahyay, my life. And wa mamati, till the end of this life, when a person die, all of that, لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, the Rabb, the Lord, of the alameen, all that exists. This ayah basically gives us the summary to the entire surah. This is what the surah is all about, Suratul An'am, and the entire Quran and the entire life of a Muslim. And this life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us versus the life that human beings, they're indulging themselves in. Life of following their desires, mixing the goals with the means, not understanding the purpose of their life. This is the life of a Muslim. And that's why it's a disgrace when we as Muslims, we do not understand the purpose of our life. When we have the Quran with us, when we recite the Quran, we get to know the meanings of it, and still a person would have things inverted. No, the matter is very clear. Everything is for the sake of Allah. And the meaning of لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ, it all belongs to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the owner of all things. And therefore, our life has to be governed according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, what's revealed in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And more, why this is the case and how this life should be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the sake of Allah, the sincerity, the purity of one's ibadah and one's life for the sake of Allah, as it's mentioned in the next verse, لا شريك له. He has no partners whatsoever. لا شريك له. No shariq, no partner whatsoever, whether it's major or small, whether it's a prophet of Allah, or whether it's someone that the people invented to be a partner with Allah, there's no partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's the only creator. There's no more than one creator to this world. And there is no one more sustainer to the people on the face of earth and all that exists except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the owner of all things in reality, the one that gives life and takes away life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything is owned by Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, He has no partners in matters of creation and provisions and so on. Therefore, He has no partners when it comes to willingly worshipping none but Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا شريك له. وبذلك أمرت وأنا أول المسلمين. By this I was ordered, commanded. This is what the Prophet ﷺ is ordered to convey. This is what I have been commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to say this and to live my life according to what you just heard. وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ مُسْلِمِينَ. I am the first among the Muslimin. I'm the first among those who submit themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willingly with perfect love and perfect submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's beautiful two verses that we as Muslims, we need to memorize these two verses. It's our way of life. If someone would ask us, what is your way of life? You can recite something like قُلْهُ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ. You can recite something like these two verses, something like Ayatul Kursi, not as an evidence that we have to do it this way, but we need to understand what our life is all about. And then we put everything in its right place. Everything will be on the same pace, not to contradict what we say. And how the salah is mentioned, which is the goal of this life, which is to establish the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and everything including the sacrifice, which is something part of the tawheed and part of what's mentioned in the surah about the people of Quraysh, how they would slaughter to other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then again, the ayah did not leave anything. وَمَحْيَا وَمَمَاتِ. My life and my death, all of that is for the sake of Allah. If we really reflect upon this, if we see our life from the moment that we wake up in the morning till the next day, is our life all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why do you get up from sleep? Why do you get up from bed? What makes you get up? What makes you leave your home in the morning if you do? What makes you move in this life? Is it for the sake of Allah or for something else? We have to change our perception. We have to change our intentions. And it's something easy by the will of Allah. Actually, this is what makes perfect sense in this life, because we all shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why the first words that comes out from the Muslim when he wakes up in the morning, Alhamdulillah alladhi ahyana ba'da ma amatana wa ilayhi an-nushur. Praise be to Allah, the one that gave us life after death, and to Him we all shall return. Then you go to make wudu, you pray fajr, you go to the masjid, and so on. And then we take the means to go, come back again to establish the salah, to establish the tawheed and the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala with this meaning and what's left from the surah right after the break. So stay with us inshallah.
محمد رسول الله.
الله سبحانه وتعالى revealed the Quran in 7 different ways of recitation. Similarly, Maryam عليه السلام, she's a woman by herself. She doesn't even have a husband who's ever touched her, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted a child to Maryam alayhi salam. Look at that. She said that, how will I have a child? وَلَمْ يَمْسَسْنِي بَشَرٌ. How will I have a child whilst I've never even been touched by a man? One of the unique things about the story is that it's not like Umar al-Khattab hasn't heard these verses. Can you imagine that Umar al-Khattab hasn't heard these verses? He became sick from the effect that this ayah ended up having on his mind.
محمد رسول الله.
الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف المرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Welcome back, and with the last four verses of Surah Al-An'am, and we talked briefly about the first two in the sequence 161, 162, and 163 from the Surah. And then after that, inshallah ta'ala, when we look into the whatever is left and contemplating and reflecting over these meanings and how the tawheed, the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is something that we need to learn, we need to be steadfast upon, and we need to perfect our iman with the understanding of the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So after we heard that the verses that talks about everything is for the sake of Allah, our salah, our sacrifice, our life and death is all for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He's the Lord of the Alameen. He has no partners whatsoever. And this is what the Prophet ﷺ has been ordered. This is what we have been ordered. وَأَنَا أَوَّلُ مُسْلِمِينَ. I'm the first among the Muslims. The first to submit oneself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then after that, in the next verse, verse 164, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَبْغِي رَبًّا وَهُوَ رَبُّ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَلَا تَكْسِبُ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ إِلَّا عَلَيْهَا وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى ثُمَّ إِلَى رَبِّكُمْ مَرْجِعُكُمْ فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ فِيهِ تَخْتَلِفُونَ. Which means, say, is it other than Allah I should desire as a Lord while He is the Lord of all things? And every soul earns not blame except against itself, and no bearer of burdens will bear the burden of another. Then to your Lord is your return, and He will inform you concerning that over which you used to differ. قُلْ أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَبْغِي رَبَّ. Another message, another statement that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordering the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام to inform mankind at the end of this beautiful surah. قُلْ, say, O Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَبْغِي رَبَّ. Is it other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ, أَغَيْرَ, asking a question, is it other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the Alameen, the creator of all things, أَبْغِي رَبَّ, I desire or I seek as a Rabb, as a Lord, as the Lord of the Alameen, the owner of all things. أغير الله أبغي رب. Is it other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only one worthy of worship, that I seek as to be my Lord, the one that sustains and creates and so on? وهو رب كل شيء. And He is the Rabb, as a fact, of all things. And what does it mean to أبغي رب? We know for a fact, as it's mentioned here, وَهُوَ رَبُّ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Rabb, is the Lord, is the owner, is the creator, the sustainer of all things. Whether people believe or disbelieve, it doesn't matter. He is the owner of all things. But then it's the human being. Are you taking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as your Lord? And that's why the oneness of lordship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala means that you believe that He's the only creator, the only sustainer, the only provider, the one that life and death is in His hands, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, our life will be accordingly. Whatever we seek the help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We seek the protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. The one that we fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. We hope for the rewards from Allah. We worship Him alone. Our salah, our nusuk, our sacrifice, our entire life is all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam forbidding something, who are we as human beings to reject this or to oppose this when it comes from the one that created us? So the point here is that if human beings, if they believe in the creator of the heavens and earth, what comes after that is very easy to be understood. But why people, they turn away from this, whether it's the desire, the arrogance forgetfulness, many things. But the verses makes it very clear that if you want to be in peace with your own self, if you don't want to fall into contradiction, then be obedient to the one that created you. The one that created you and fashioned you and provide for you and keep on providing for you. And the one that created you without taking your permission, and at the moment of death, you won't be able to make a decision to stay longer. It's all under the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So therefore, be obedient to Him. Worship Him alone, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take Him as your Lord. So therefore, you would put things in the right perspective. You would worship Him alone, you would be obedient to Him, you would follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then after that, the verse makes it very clear, وَلَا تَكْسِبُ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ إِلَّا عَلَيْهَا, that every soul only earns what's upon it, meaning that whatever you earn, you are going to see this. This is something that shows that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. That every person, whatever we do in this life, we are earning our way, whether to the Jannah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared for the believers, paradise, or the hellfire that shows the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not treat His creation with injustice, because He's the Lord and the owner of all things. He's the most just, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So every soul earns anything is against its own self. That's why the disbelievers, when they entered the hellfire in the day of judgment, they cursed themselves, because the matter was made very clear to them, but they chose to follow their desires and not the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then more with the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وَزْرَ أُخْرَى, and no one shall bear the sin of another. وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وَزْرَ أُخْرَى, there is no exception whatsoever to this. There's no bearer of burdens will bear the burden of another. Everybody will bear their own burden. People were not going to take the sins of others. As the disbelievers, they suggested that. They suggested that to the believers. That they said to them, اتبعوا سبيلنا ولنحمل خطاياكم وما هم بحملين من خطاياهم من شيء إنهم لكاذبون. That they said to the believers, the disbelievers, as a way of mockery or whatever there is, they said, follow our ways and we will carry your sins on our backs. Some people actually, they say this when someone would be invited to follow people with a sin or something wrong, and he would refuse and he would say, I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is not permissible. You would find sometimes people would say, come with us, we'll take your sin, we'll bear your sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran, that they are liars because this is not something for them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the owner of all things. And He said subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا تَزِرُ وَازِرَةٌ وَزْرَ أُخْرَى, nobody will bear the burden and the sin of another. This is a way of life. This is not something that would ever change. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most just. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He made every single human being responsible for their actions, so there's no need for a prophet to come to wipe away the sins of the people. Or as the Christians, they claim that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a son, wal'iyadhu billah, and then He sent His son for him to be sacrificed for the sins of the people. You know, this doesn't make sense even intellectually when it comes to matters of justice. Imagine someone was taken to prison to be slaughtered because of the sin of his father or because of a sin of someone else or a crime that he never committed. Where is this justice? The justice says that nobody is to bear the burden of another. Every person is responsible for their actions. So we earn it. And that's why we have to be patient with the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And with this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiver. He's the most merciful. So no matter what a person put upon himself with sins and disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and evil actions, which leads the person to the hellfire, if a person turns to Allah in repentance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiver. And then after that, ثُمَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ مَرْجِعُكُمْ فَيُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِمَا كُنْتُمْ فِيهِ تَخْتَلِفُونَ, then everybody shall return to Allah and He will inform you what used to differ among yourselves. The matter does not need for people to differ. The matter is very clear. And all of you shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where the matter will become then clearer and clearer. But then it's too late for those who disobeyed Allah and disbelieved in Him. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from that. We'll continue inshallah ta'ala in the last verse, in the surah, but right after the break. So stay with us inshallah.
Muhammadur Rasulullah.
God is the Quran, our religion is Islam. Five noble pillars upholding what is virtuous.
It's calling us to establish this hiwa, this dialogue between ourselves and between the non-Muslim, and to use hikmah. The waves are coming, you're trapped. Fitna every is coming everywhere. How can I get out of this fitna that I'm in? Send me the rope. Why did Allah send the Quran to you, to all of mankind? As a source of guidance, as a kitab, a blessed book to be reflected upon. And secondly, the ba'th, the resurrection. Prepare yourself for Yawm al-Qiyamah, when you're going to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is aqidah, this is the core of aqidah, this is the focus of the Qur'an. They want these dialects and these slangs to spread so the Arabs themselves can't even understand the Qur'an properly. This is a choice you have to make now. Because once the angel of death comes to you and takes your soul, there's no turning back, there's no other choice.
Pilgrimage and charity. To make the testimony is the base of the faith, and the fast and the prayer, the pilgrimage and charity.
Muhammadur Rasulullah.
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu wa ashrafi mursaleen, nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Welcome back, and with the last verse of Surah Al-An'am, this blessed surah, that as we heard, the subject is a beautiful subject. It's difficult to leave it, but it's leaving it to another beautiful thing, which is still the Quran. There's nothing more pleasurable in this life, really, sincerely, if we really taste the Quran the way it ought to be, than to be busy with the Quran, to be busy reciting it and reflecting upon its meaning and living what the Quran and these verses are teaching us, because it's the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and nothing is the like of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the kalam and the speech of Allah is one of His attributes. The last verse in Surah Al-An'am, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَكُمْ خَلَائِفَ الْأَرْضِ وَرَفَعَ بَعْضَكُمْ فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ دَرَجَاتٍ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ فِي مَا آتَاكُمْ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ سَرِيعُ الْعِقَابِ وَإِنَّهُ لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعْلَكُمْ خَلَائِفْ means, and it is He who has made you successors upon the earth and has raised some of you above others in degrees of rank, that He may try you through what He has given you. Indeed, your Lord is swift in penalty, but indeed He is forgiving and merciful. وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعْلَكُمْ خَلَائِفَ الْأَرْضِ. It is He, وَهُوَ. And how this is mentioned in very clear words, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord of the Alameen, Rabbil Alameen, as it's mentioned before, the one that is Rabbu Kulli Shay, the Lord of all things, as mentioned before in the previous ayah, it is He subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one Alladhi Ja'alakum, the one that made you Khala'if al-Ard. Khala'if, and you are familiar with the word Khalifa, successor. So He made you successors on the face of earth. Whether this is referred to every single human being, we came from someone else, and one generation from one generation, and all the way to Adam alayhi salam. We find ourselves on the face of earth, walking and talking and so on, and we inherited this from those who came before us. And the same way, we would leave this earth, and we would leave it for those who come after us. Who's the one that made us in such a way? If you look on top of the earth from a distance, you won't see that the human being or the generation that is present now will all disappear and the earth is empty, and then the new generation comes in. The life and how life is, people dying, people born, and the busyness and the life and the motion and the movement of this life is such a miraculous thing. Who is the one that made life like this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You do not feel that the generation are being replaced by another. It's one after the other, with very precise time of ending of one's life and so on. Also, as the ulama, they say, it refers to this ummah of the Prophet والسلام, that this nation, the followers of the Prophet والسلام, they are successor from those who came before them. Before them, they were the Jews and the Christians and so on. So now this is the ummah where everybody should follow its messenger. The Prophet والسلام, is sent to all mankind. And this is the final ummah, because there's no more messenger to come. And it's going to be the first to enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be occupied, most of it, by the people, the followers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعْلَكُمْ خَلَائِفَ الْأَرْضِ. To pay attention that it's now your chance. We're reciting the Qur'an now. People recited it before us. But now we're reciting it that we are now present, we're still alive, so that we fulfill the purpose of our life, and that is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the angels, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً, that I'm having or making on the face of earth khalifa, someone that they would succeed one another, and also means someone that will be given the choice whether to follow the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and establish the ubudiyyah, the servitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or not. وَرَفَعَ بَعْضَكُمْ فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ دَرَجَّةٍ وَرَفَعَ, he elevated, raised بَعْضَكُمْ, some of you, فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ, over the other. So that means human beings are not all the same, and we see that we are separated with ranks, not necessarily physical, which is, yes, it's very clear that it's physical. Some people are richer than others. Some people are rich, some people are poor. Some people are of authority, and some people, they are not of authority. Some people, they are in some level of honor and dignity, and some people are humiliated on the face of earth. We see how people are divided in so many different ranks on the face of earth. People are not the same. And it cannot be the case. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that created them. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, He could make all of them kings and rulers and rich people and have all whatever they seek on the face of earth. This is, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, He would have made things like this. But this is not the case. You would find how people living in this life, some people serve others, some people are having, they have money, others they don't, and so on and so forth. But what's the purpose of this? All of that is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that created us. Is it like that without any plan, without any purpose? Of course not. He's the Rabb, He's the Lord of the Alameen. That's why right after this it says, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ فِيمَ أَتَكُمْ, to test you, to try you in whatever He gave you. So if you're poor, you are being tried. If you're rich, you are being tried. If you are a person of authority, you are being tried, and you will be asked about it in the day of resurrection. If you are someone that is under an authority, you will be tried also. People are a trial to one another. We are test to one another. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَجَعَلْنَا بَعْضَكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ فِتْنَةً أَتَصْبِرُونَ, we made you to one another a trial, fitna. أَتَصْبِرُونَ, should you then be patient? So this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's why the rulings in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ is accordingly. You would find whatever rank, whatever position you are on the face of earth, you would find rulings and things to observe to fulfill the purpose of our life. If a person is a husband, he will be asked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about this position. How did he take care of his family, his wife, his children? A wife will be asked, as the Prophet ﷺ said in the beautiful hadith, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُونَ عَنْ رَعْيَتِهِ, each and every one of you, رَاعٍ, you're responsible for something. And you will be asked about your responsibility. Everybody will be asked. And therefore, anything that we are given, فِيمَا أَتَاكُمْ, anything that Allah gave you, you will be asked about it. It's a test from Allah. This is how we change our perception as Muslims. So whenever a person has something, it's not because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves him. If someone has so much money, has so much good health and so on, this doesn't mean necessarily that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with that person. You are given this لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ, for you to be tested. Are you being grateful? Are you establishing the purpose of your life as it's mentioned in verse number 162, in the beginning of the episode? Your salah, your nusuk, your life and death, is it for the sake of Allah? Or it's for the sake of showing off and your own self and your own desires and sins and so on. If you are given whatever you are given, it's a test from Allah. And if you're not given something, it's also a test from Allah. Someone is given wealth, but then something from his health is taken away. He's being sick. Someone is given health and wealth and so on. Someone is given knowledge of the deen. Someone doesn't have the knowledge of the deen. To ask the people of knowledge. And the people of knowledge, they have a responsibility to convey the truth to the people, not to hide the truth as the nations before did, and so on. We can go on and on with the details of this. But then as you see here, this is the reality of this life. Relate this to what the surah mentions and what the entire Quran is talking about. And then the last part of the surah, the last part of the verse, إِنَّ رَبَّكَ سَرِيعُ الْعِقَابِ وَإِنَّهُ لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, that indeed your Lord, سَرِيعُ الْعِقَابِ, سَرِيعَ, fast in punishment. that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His punishment is swift, very, 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 very near, very close, swift in penalty. But indeed, وَإِنَّهُ لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ, and He is forgiving and merciful. So this is basically warning to those who would oppose the orders of Allah as they are mentioned in the surah, those who oppose the tawheed, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refuted their calls and made the evidences very clear to them so that they would worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, warning them at the end of the surah that don't think that because you're still living, you're still eating and drinking and enjoying your power and so on, that the punishment and the penalty would not afflict you. No, the matter is very swift. And imagine, just for us now when we're listening to this, these verses when it was revealed to the Prophet والسلام, to the people of Quraysh, the people in Mecca, and they were disbelievers and mocking at the Prophet والسلام, and the believers and saying all of these things that we heard in the surah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning them, where are they now? They are returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as it's mentioned in the previous verse. They are returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they received the punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they died in the state of disbelief. That's why it's very swift, it's very near. And we are living now on the face of earth, and before we know it, everybody shall return to Allah. We see that how death is every day, that we know someone or people that we do not know, people are returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, each one is taking their turn. And the matter is very near, and that's why the Prophet ﷺ, he said, أَكْثِرُوا ذِكْرَ هَذِي مِنْ لَذَّاتِ, frequently mention the destroyer of the desires, which is death, because it puts you in check, make you see the reality of this life. But then after mentioning that he is swift in punishment, so that people have the fear of Allah, and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before it's too late, then at the end, وَإِنَّهُ لَغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ, and indeed, he is غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ, he is the most forgiver, the most merciful. And you see there's something very delicate here if you pay attention to the last sentence here. وَإِنَّهُ لَغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ, the lamb here gives more stresses to these attributes which is not present in إِنَّ رَبَّكَ. It did not say إِنَّ رَبَّكَ لَسَرِيعُ الْعِقَابِ. It says إِنَّ رَبَّكَ سَرِيعُ الْعِقَابِ. He's swift in penalty and punishment. But see the next one, وَإِنَّهُ لَغَفُورُ. Did not say وَإِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ وَإِنَّهُ لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. That by Allah, indeed, no doubt, He's the most forgiver, the most merciful. To comfort the believers, to comfort those who would repent to Allah after they are mentioned in the surah, if they committed kufr and disbelief and associating partners with Allah that requires a severe punishment from Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is comforting them because He's the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. Comforting them if they repent to Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive all of their sins. And He's the most merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why it's stressed here with this lamb to make it even very clear that there's no excuse anymore. If you, whatever you did, if you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive your sins. And He's the most merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But then, when are you going to return to Allah? And as if this is like the end of the surah, so that's it. You need to repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Leave this shirk, leave this associating partners with Allah, and return to the tawheed and the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and enjoy the life of being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before the punishment would come, and enjoy being among those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive their sins, not just forgiving their sins and that's it. He is also Rahim, He's the most merciful. He would make them enter Jannah if they would repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and turn away from this shirk and associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The surah has beautiful meanings, as we said, and we need to really reflect upon them and learn from what the subjects and the objectives of the surah is basically saying, which is basically the matters of tawheed. But because of the time, we'll end here inshallah ta'ala with the surah, and then next time inshallah ta'ala we'll talk about the next surah, Suratul A'raf, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us benefit from such a beautiful surah and the entire Quran, and to make us all among the people of the Quran. These are the people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who receive the mercy and the forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So till next time, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect you all. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa barak ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Illa alladhina tabu wa aslahu wa bayyanu fa'ulaika atubu alayhim wa ana at-tawwabur rahim.
Fad'u Allah muslim. مخلصين له الدين ولو كره الكافرون
يا زكريا إنا نبشرك بغلام
يا أيها النبي إنا أرسلناك شاهداً